So as I mentioned, it's 20 years since I last stood on the stage, and it is an extreme privilege to be here. So thank you to both Mrs. Frayn and Mrs. Jarvis for inviting me to speak today. It also is incredibly daunting to talk here. I look out and I see so many young, beautiful faces looking up at me, some who I know have already, in the prime of your life, experienced grief. Or watched your friends grieve and not quite knowing what to do. And so I want to acknowledge up front each one of you who has already experienced loss and has already experienced this pain and who struggled to cope with it, and to say that I am sorry. I wish that there was something that I could do to protect you from the pain, but I know that there isn't, as much as I would like to be able to. So I hope through my story I'm able to provide you with just a little bit of guidance and to help you see light when there may only be darkness. Please don't be scared to cry during the speech if it touches you in that way. You can blame me for crying. Feel free, this really is a safe space. Grief is such a taboo subject and makes so many people feel unbelievably uncomfortable in talking about it, dealing with it, and in facing it head on. And I hope that in sharing with you today, I'm able to help you in your most formative years to develop skills that not a lot of people have, and ones which I know will be invaluable to you as you grow up. I'm going to open myself up to you tonight to be extremely vulnerable, so thank you for allowing me to do that. I had the privilege of growing up in Grahamstown. I started off my school career in the Owls class at St. Andrew's Pre-Primary and went all the way through to matric. And I use the word privilege very specifically because it truly was a privilege to go to a school like DSG. I was one of four children, and I remember once saying to my dad, "Dad, why can't we go on an overseas holiday?" And he turned to me and he said to me, "My girl, instead of overseas holidays, I choose to send you to a school like DSG because I believe that is the best gift that I can give you." And I remember at the time not really getting it, but as I've grown older, I've realized the huge gift that it was that my father gave me. My DSG friends are still my closest friends to this day. We are a huge support network to each other, and it's really not often that I see this kind of support amongst women these days. DSG somehow manages to cultivate some really special connections and some really incredible women. And without those, my journey would have been much more difficult. DSG also supported me in my most significant years and gave me the tools to deal with the things in my life, the things that have been thrown at me in my life since. That of resilience, hope, stamina, courage, self-aware and self-control, never being a victim, making active choices in my life, and the true beauty of friendship. Our headmaster up until I was in Standard 7 was Mr. Wynn, and he used to stand right here on the stage, and he'd say in the Monday morning in assembly, very frequently, he would say, "Girls, there are three kinds of people in this world. Those who make things happen, those who watch things happen, and those who wondered what happened. Make sure you're in the first category." And what I know about DSG girls and the people that I've had the privilege to interact with more recently is that you are girls who make things happen. When I was in grade 10, a lady called Alison came to speak to us. Alison lived in PE and she wrote a book called Eye of Life. And she was brutally raped and left for dead. And instead of falling apart, she used her experience to try and help others. She wanted to teach people that we are, each of us, valuable beyond measure, and that we need to make choices that honor us. Life can sometimes make us feel like the victim. Problems and hardships and traumas are dished out to all of us. And sometimes it can seem really, really divided unfairly. We feel hard done by and understandably sorry for ourselves. Life feels like a survival for race from one event to another. We may not choose what happens to us in life. We cannot control what other people say or do or the problems that come our way. But we can always control how we respond. Life is not a collection of what happens to you, but of how you've responded to what has happened to you. So I'm sure by now you're all wondering why I'm standing up here and what qualifies me to talk about grief. So I'm going to share a little bit of my story with you. can remember, I had a very idyllic life until the age of 8. And then one Wednesday evening, my until then completely sheltered life changed forever. My mom, Lindy, who you'll see up in those pictures there, she was actually the SAN sister here at DSG at the time. She died from complications post a car accident, leaving myself, I was 8, my brother Matthew was 6, and my sister Sam, who was 3, and obviously my dad. In that moment, the path of my life changed forever. And I truly believe that it was the loss of my mom and what it taught me that has enabled me to overcome what I have since. I'm the only one of my siblings who really has any memory of my mom at all. And while I think I have those memories, they certainly have faded over time. I often wonder if I only have them because of photographs that I've seen or because of stories that people have told me, as opposed to actually remembering it all. What I do remember, though, is the way that people supported us over that time, and Grantstown really did rally around us. But I did grow up feeling different at a time where all I desperately wanted to do was fit in. I didn't want to be different. I had to grow up very quickly, become a mom to my brother and sister in many ways, and I lost a part of my childhood that I will never regain. We didn't really grow up speaking about my mom, not because we weren't allowed to, but also because we weren't encouraged to. Because grief is hard and it's uncomfortable. And I know that to this day, my dad, to this day, 29 years later, still cries if we speak about my mom. Looking back now, I realize that our family went into survival mode. And I don't think that any of us really grieved my mom at all, certainly not at the time, anyway. The focus was on surviving and just getting on with things. And society 29 years ago was certainly not in tune with helping people with their loss. There was no such thing as a school counselor or psychologist, and people tended to be much more closed and private. Generally, the approach was get on with things, put it in a box, and you'll be fine. But I think that we all know that while this may work for a certain period of time, sometimes even years, at some stage that box will open and bite you in the bum. I remember about 9 months after my mom died, I just started here in grade 4 at DSG, and my piano teacher asked me to please go home and ask my mom to cut my fingernails because they were clicking on the piano. And I remember not being able to find the words to tell her that my mom had died. I refused to go to piano lessons for the next week or two until I picked up the guts to tell my dad what had happened and ask him for help in dealing with this. Quite a lot for a 9-year-old little girl to have to deal with. I also remember refusing to go to a psychologist for many, many years after my mom's death because I didn't see the point in talking about my stuff. About 18 months after my mom died, I was behaving badly and someone turned around to me and said, "You know, just because your mom's died doesn't mean you can behave however you like." Quite harsh to say to a 10-year-old, but a really important life lesson, which has defined my life going forward. Because as Alison said, we may not choose what happens to us in life. We cannot control what other people do or say, or the problems that come our way, but we can always control how we respond. When I was 10, my dad married Debbie, and at the age of 23, she took on the mammoth task of parenting 3 children who were not biologically her own. When I was 18 years old, they got divorced, and I went through a period of grief around this as well, as the family that I had known for the 9 years no longer existed in that form. I was then diagnosed with cancer for the first time when I was 23 years old. I got it relatively lightly first time round, but it then came back much more aggressively when I was 29 years old in my lymph glands. I had to have 4 operations, quite a lot of radiation, and then really, besides the battle with lymphedema, I carried on with life as normal. I was told at the time that because of the area that they had to radiate, I may not be able to have children, but I was so focused on beating the cancer that I didn't really think too much about that. I then met my amazing husband, James. We got married. And when we looked at trying to have children, we did testing and we were told that I would never be able to have kids because I was producing no eggs and was completely infertile. I remember being really upset at the time, and James, in his forever positive way, said to me, "Simone, you never know what might happen." And 3 months later, I was pregnant with Mary. He was born on the 7th of October 2013, and I really did believe that he was our miracle child and that we wouldn't have any more children. And then, 7 months later, I fell pregnant with our daughter, Bella. She was born on the 1st of February 2015, and I really did feel like the luckiest person in the world. And then, everything changed. At about 2 p.m. on the 15th of September, our darling Belzy, there she is up there, at 7.5 months old, died when she asphyxiated in her cot at her midday sleep when I was at work. Our life was changed in that instant forever. It's impossible to find the words to describe that day or the days that followed as we tried to get to grips with the fact that our daughter was no longer with us, that we would never see her again, and that life as we knew it, the future that we had imagined, was no longer our reality. Everybody's journey with grief is different, and some of you would already have experienced that, and James and I were certainly no exception to this. We grieved completely differently. For the first few months, James cried pretty much solidly. He didn't stop. I, on the other hand, went into complete cope mode, just trying desperately to hold things together for our family. And I realized, looking back, that I was in complete shock and didn't really start to process it at all. And then as James started to cry a little less, our reality started to set in for me, and I, luckily, was able to mourn while James was able to hold our family together. I must just add that my husband is also no stranger to grief and to loss. His father committed suicide when he was 8 years old. Very soon after Bella died, James and I fell pregnant again. I truly believed that this little boy that I was carrying was a gift sent to us directly from Bella, and that he was going to help put a bandage on our broken heart. Quite something to place on an unborn child. And for the first 6 months, our pregnancy went according to plan. And then at 26 weeks and 3 days, after quite a lot of medical complications, our little boy Thomas was born, weighing in at a hefty 700 grams. He lived for 3 hours, and despite the amazing medical team who attended to him, he died as well. This was when I really, really hit rock bottom, and James was able to pick up the pieces to really enable me to grieve. Many of the months that followed, to be honest, I don't remember at all. They are pretty much a complete blur to me. I was not only grieving one child, but actually grieving two. It was like watching my life from above, seeing it happen, but not partaking in any way. I've had so many people tell me that if their child, mom, dad, partner died, they just wouldn't be able to cope and wouldn't be able to carry on. And some of you will already know that this just isn't true. You have to carry on. You need to keep on living. You are forever changed, and you will never go back to who you were before. But life does continue, even though sometimes you really don't want it to. Your life does become divided between BD and AD, before death and after death. And now generally everything I think about is around that timeline. Our little boy Murray, who's up there, he's now 5.5. He also kept us going. We had to get out of bed every day. We had to continue to function. On that afternoon that Bella died, I still needed to bath him and put him to bed, that day and every day thereafter. And I truly thank God for that, because we have been determined to not allow Murray's entire life to be impacted by the loss of his siblings, for it not to result in the emotional loss of his parents as well, because Murray is the gift and the miracle that we still have, and we need to embrace and appreciate this with every fiber of our being. So that's a bit of insight into why I stand before you today. Just after our precious Bella died, about 10 days after she died, James came home to me and he said to me, in between his tears, he said to me, "Guess what I've done? I've started a blog." And I looked at him and I was appalled that he could be putting our feelings and what had happened to us out there into the world and making us so vulnerable, where we had no control over who would be reading what we were saying and what they would be doing with it. However, what I have come to realize is that our blog has become one of the most powerful tools in both the processing of our own grief, as well as helping others to know how to deal with us and where we're at. What has also become extremely powerful is how our blog has been used to help others who have experienced loss. It's often so hard to find words to explain how you are feeling, and I gained huge comfort from reading what other people had written. And so in turn, we've been able to use our blog to help others and to empower those close to them to support them better. Somehow, in being able to do this, it makes us feel like our children's loss isn't completely in vain, that we allow their lives and names to live on beyond their time on this earth, and that we're creating a legacy for them. Both James and I have been so privileged to have been supported incredibly in so many different ways by our family, friends, and community, not only in the loss of our children, but in the things that have happened to us subsequent to that. And this is largely why I've been able to share on this subject as I have, because we have been blessed in this way, and we know what it means to be carried and protected by others. Sometimes you just can't tell anybody how you really feel, not because you don't know why, not because you don't know your purpose, not because you don't trust them, but because you can't find the right words to make them understand. Loss is all around us all the time. Nobody is unaffected by loss, and everybody's response to loss is different. What I have learned, however, is that society in general is completely ill-equipped to deal with grief. Your minds would reel at some of the things that have been said to me about the loss of my children. It's quite bizarre, as the only thing certain in life is death, and yet we are not given the tools we need to know how to cope with it, or how to interact with those that are grieving. What I have found is that while everybody does grieve differently, there certainly are a number of commonalities that people generally seek out, and so I'd like to share some of those with you today. If you know someone who has lost a very important person in their life, and you're afraid to mention it because you think you may make the person sad by reminding them of someone who died, you're not reminding them, they didn't forget. What you're reminding them of is that you remembered that the person lived, and this is a great, great gift. When you see someone who you know has experienced a loss, even if you don't know them well, always acknowledge it. More often than not, this acknowledgement will be so appreciated. Remember, as this says, you are not reminding them that the person died. The fact that Bella, Thomas, and my mom died is with me pretty much every second of the day. And so by you acknowledging it, it's making the other person feel okay, that their feelings are allowed and validated, like they can be real and authentic with you and really share their innermost beings. I'm also often told that I just don't know what to say. Guess what? There are three very powerful words. I am sorry. You don't have to say anything profound. I am sorry perfectly suffices. Sometimes we need someone to simply be there, not to fix anything or to do anything in particular, but just to let us feel that we are cared for and supported. Sadly, our culture has treated grief as a problem to be solved, an illness to be healed, or both. In the process, we've done everything we can to avoid, ignore, or transform grief. And as a result, when you're faced with tragedy, you usually find that you're no longer surrounded by people, you're surrounded by platitudes. When a person is devastated by grief, the last thing they need is advice. Their world has been completely shattered. This means that the act of inviting someone in is an act of extreme risk. To try and fix it or rationalize away their pain only deepens their fear. Instead, the most powerful thing you can do is acknowledge. Literally say the words, "I acknowledge your pain. I am here with you." Sit quietly with them, saying very, very little, but letting them know through your presence that you are supporting them. Say our loved ones' names often, over and over again. We are desperate to hear it, to know that they haven't been forgotten. While it may make you feel uncomfortable, it will be so much appreciated. On the days when no one but you mentions their name, I am so, so sorry. Say their name bravely. Know that they are still real, they are still here, and that they are still yours. Don't be scared to bring up your friend's mom or dad who has died, to ask them questions about them, to help keep their memories alive, even if you didn't know them. Also, don't be scared to talk about your parents around them. Often you think that it's better not to because you think it might be hurtful for them. But if it's done in a sensitive way, I'm sure that most of the time they will really appreciate it being included in the conversation instead of being excluded and made to feel even more on the outside. Don't ask what you can do to help. Take the initiative and just do it. When somebody is in a period of grief, they actually don't know what they need. So most of the time, whatever you do will probably be just right. For us, it was grocery shopping being done and meals being delivered to us. For 3 months after both Thomas and Bella died, I never had to go to the grocery shops and I didn't have to cook a single meal. This was the best thing that people could have done for us. For you, it might be going for a walk with your friend, helping them out with some homework when they really just can't concentrate, letting your room be a safe space for them, or maybe just picking them a flower just to remind them that you love them. Just so you know, I can't stop grieving just because you believe it is time for me to move on. I can't stop hurting just because you do not understand the piercing pain in my heart. I can't stop my tears from flowing just because they make you uncomfortable. My heart is not suddenly mended just because you believe I have grieved long enough. I will grieve the loss of my loved one for the rest of my life. Our loss will change us forever. Be patient with us and understand this. Don't expect your old friend to emerge after the socially acceptable 2 weeks of grief. Very seldom is this going to happen. A loss that is not within the normal course of events will change your life forever. I will grieve for a lifetime. For me, there's no moving on or getting over it. There is no fix. Because death is not just one finite event. It's not about the day your loved one died, but it's about every single milestone after that that you don't get to share with them. It's every should've, could've, would've been. Also remember that there are 2 days a year that will be especially hard for your friend. Their loved one's birthday and the day that they died. And often, certainly for me anyway, the days leading up to these 2 days are actually almost worse than the day itself. Sometimes I feel like I have bricks pressing on my chest and that I can barely breathe. Put these days in your diary so that you don't forget. And if your friend is being impossible and really just really difficult to like, remember, maybe that's why, and cut them a little bit of slack. Social situations that you can't control or predict can often be extremely challenging as well. You don't know if people know how they will react and how you should react. It's often easier if you have your team of people around you to support you and protect you, but sometimes that isn't the case. Be sensitive to this when including somebody who has experienced a loss into a social situation. Perhaps give the other people a heads up of what's happened so that difficult questions can be avoided. For us, the questions around, for me particularly, how old is your daughter now? Last time I saw you, you were pregnant. How, you know, you have 2 children, don't you? Those were always particularly difficult things for me to answer, especially in the beginning. And also ensure that you are consistent in your support. People imagine that missing a loved one works kind of like missing chocolate, he said. The first day is really hard, the next day is less hard, and so forth. Easier and easier the longer you go on. But instead, it's actually like missing water. Every day you notice the person's absence more. While for those who are not directly impacted, you grieve and then you get on with your life, as you should. You don't need to forget, but you do. Be there, not just when it happens, not in the weeks after, but in the months and years ahead. Because unfortunately, the grief actually does get worse in the months after the event, once the shock has worn off and the hardcore reality starts to set in. That's when a grieving person really needs you. And I know that we are not always the easiest people to be friends with. In fact, we can be really pretty difficult sometimes. But please try and continue with your support, even when we can't find the words to thank you. Because trust me, we really do appreciate it. Most people who experience grief will probably feel some sort of depression and or anxiety. I know I certainly did. For some people, this can be relatively short-lived, and for others, this may be very protracted. understand that in this time, the depression can really actually fundamentally change your brain. Sometimes I thought I was actually going crazy. You will not retain anything. You will have pretty much zero recall. And unless things are written down, that absolutely won't happen. You will feel like you are standing above yourself, looking down on your life. For most, this cognitive gap will get better, but it is real, very, very real. If it's you, try and be patient with yourself. And if you are watching your friend, please try and have zero expectations of them. Remember this, grief is not a disorder, a disease, or a sign of weakness. It is an emotional, physical, and spiritual necessity, the price you pay for love. The only cure for grief is to grieve. I also found it very difficult when people would say to me after my children died, they're in a better place. Because as a mom, I couldn't believe that anywhere other than having my children in my arms could be a better place. Also, if somebody says to you, everything happens for a reason, remember this quote. Let me be crystal clear. If you faced a tragedy and someone tells you in any way, shape, or form that your tragedy was meant to be, that it happened for a reason, that it will make you a better person, or that taking responsibility for it will fix it, you have every right to remove them from your life. Some things in life cannot be fixed. They can only be carried. So I've spoken about it. I feel like I'm standing up here on my soapbox and speaking a lot about what others should learn and be aware of and how you can help those that are grieving. But I've also done so much self-reflection in this journey that I've been on, and I'd like to share that with you today. When you grieve, you do not grieve in a straight line. It pretty much looks something like this. It has its own timeline and its own rhythm. We all know about the five stages of grief: denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and acceptance. And while everybody tends to feel every stage most of the time, it doesn't move in a nice linear fashion, which for a control freak like me, who likes to be able to tick things off lists and get them done, this was not easy to get my head around. You can get stuck on certain stages for a long period of time, and you can go back to certain stages. And that is okay, as long as you are doing the work and allowing yourself to feel, not shutting down. You will reach some kind of acceptance. I can't stress enough how important it is to allow yourself to grieve and to feel, and not to put it in a box, as can be so tempting to do, and as I did around my mom's death for very, very many years. You also never go back to who you were before. People speak about bouncing back, but that doesn't happen, or at least not in my experience, because bouncing back implies that you go back to the person that you were before. I have found that I've also found this loss of who I was before. I've mourned this as well. I've mourned the simplicity of how life used to be. Grief is like living two different lives. One where you pretend everything is all right, and the other is where your heart silently screams in pain. Getting to grips with letting go of the notion of what life should be is tough. You are forever changed. And this isn't necessarily a bad thing, but you do have to accept it and not fight against it. And then once you've done this, you have to try and move from surviving to thriving. And this is the real hard part and where I find myself right now. The benefits of therapy, and I promise you that Mrs. Jarvis didn't put me up to talking about this section in my speech. For some reason, there is still a massive stigma around therapy. And there is the belief that people need to be suffering a debilitating mental illness or going through an interpersonal issue for getting this sort of help. I think this was the reason that I pushed against therapy for so many years when I was younger, because I didn't want somebody to think that there was something wrong with me or that I wasn't normal. In almost every single other aspect of our lives, we embrace upskilling ourselves, learning more to make us better at the things that we do. We do additional courses, read extensively, and are generally proactive about learning how to do new things and getting help to do those. There are very few areas in your life where you are just expected to know how to do something. You want to learn to speak French? Go to some French classes. You want to learn to surf? Go to Musenberg Beach and get a hopefully hot surf instructor. And yet, for some reason, when it comes to ourselves and our emotional needs and feelings, we tend to be incredibly slow and reticent about equipping ourselves at doing a better job at coping with our emotions. People who are hurting don't need avoiders, protectors, or fixers. What we need are patient, loving witness, people to sit quietly and hold space for us, people to stand in helpful vigil to our pain. A psychologist is objective and is objective and can be honest with you without being scared of offending you. We all have people in our lives we can rely upon and talk to, and this is an amazing gift, but a psychologist forms a very different role. They help you to process things that would otherwise often be just too difficult to think about. Not only do you talk through things, but you develop invaluable skills for your life going forward. One of the most powerful tools that I have developed in helping me deal with grief is my relationship with my psychologist. In the beginning, when I started seeing her, it was about 6 weeks after Thomas died. And all we did for the first little while was focus on getting me through every day without feeling like I was going to implode. And then as I started to cope better with life, we started to think about the real tough things. Things like what to do with Bella and Thomas's ashes, what to do with Bella's belongings and her bedroom, my husband and I grieving completely differently, and how to help my grieving child. I would not be in the place that I am today had I not made that investment in myself. And I encourage each one of you, whether you've experienced grief, loss, or anything else, to develop this kind of relationship and invest in yourself in this way. Resilience is a subject I've spent so much time thinking about. It is during the deepest throes of grief and loss that we discover our resilience. We are moved to examine what really matters, what makes us strong, what drains us, and what moves us forward. It's not one of life's easiest lessons, but it is a catalyst for a tremendous amount of change and introspection. There is a gift in that, if we can let ourselves see it as we move through the pain. So what is resilience? Because it's a word that's used a lot. It's the multifaceted ability to process, adapt to, and overcome adversity, challenge, and change. It enhances our ability to grow in significant ways, to build a life that is not just about surviving, but about thriving. What makes some people more resilient than others? Is it life experiences that shape resilience, or is it your approach to life that drives resilience? We all learn something about ourselves in difficult times. Through these times, certain people manage to maintain their emotional balance. Instead of slipping into despair for long periods of time, they remain optimistic and focused enough to generally keep going with their lives. One thing I know for sure is that DSG manages to create some incredibly resilient women. DSG girls literally bounce. What interests me about resilience is it something that develops because of challenges, or is it something that is a pre-existing personality trait? Sheryl Sandberg, who is the COO of Facebook, wrote in her book Option B, which she wrote after her husband Dave died. She says that resilience is like a muscle. We all have it, but it needs to be exercised to be developed and built. I recently did a resilience retreat. It was one of the most difficult but rewarding things I've ever done. I won't lie, before going there, I thought I was pretty resilient. I thought I had this resilience thing pretty sorted. And one of the beginning exercises we had to do was answer 40 questions around resilience. And then you came and you had to mark it at the end. And I was convinced I would get full marks. And when I didn't get full marks, I started going back through the test, not listening to what the lady was saying at all, but going back through the test, figuring out how I could get a better score and prove that I was resilient enough. So I'm not competitive at all, as you can tell. But the area that it did highlight for me that I needed to work on was my inability to be vulnerable and to reach out to people and to ask for help. And so this brings me to one of the biggest things I have personally learned in the last 3 years, and one which I'm still battling with to this day, my ability to be vulnerable. And I think it's something that has been entrenched in me from very, very little, that I can cope with everything on my own, and that I don't need to look outside of my very small family circle for help. and this isn't healthy or right. What vulnerability looks like is different for everybody. For some, it's saying, I love you for the first time. For others, it's initiating intimate contact or speaking about their mom and dad who died. For me, it's asking for help and acknowledging that I can't do it all by myself. Brené Brown writes about it. Daring greatly means the courage to be vulnerable. It means to show up and be seen, to ask for what you need, to talk about how you're feeling, and to have those hard conversations. Remember that vulnerability is actually courage. It is not weakness. To allow ourselves to be honest and exposed. As a result of courage, Brené Brown also says here, the difficult thing is that vulnerability is the first thing I look for in you and the last thing I'm willing to show you. In you, it's courage and daring. In me, it's weakness. Just think about that a little bit. I know that for me personally, one of the best things a friend can do is ask me for help. Ask me to look after their children, cook them a meal. I'm sure a lot of you are the same, that you love being told, you love being asked for help by your friends. And yet for me, this is something I cannot do unless I'm actually paying someone to do it for me. And so this is something I'm needing to work really hard on. It's also not thinking that people should just know what you need. Because trust me, they want to know what you need, but they just don't. So it's also about verbalizing what you need and how you need it done. And I'm pretty sure that people will appreciate that kind of guidance. I also realized at this resilience retreat that my circle of support had become smaller and smaller, completely out of my own doing. I had pushed people away because to continue to share my life and story and to be vulnerable became more and more difficult as every single Blankenberg disaster unfolded. Trust me, people were going, oh my word, it's those bloody Blankenbergs again. It was also that as we continued to face challenge after challenge, people stopped sharing their lives with us because in their minds, their problems just didn't seem big enough. This is a very, very common response, but couldn't be further from the truth. And so this becomes a vicious cycle. As we showed less vulnerability and shared less, people shared less with us, we then shared less with them, and so it went on. Vulnerability involves listening, validating, and sharing common experiences. When we are in the depths of grief, to have someone open themselves up to the pain of our emotional experience, to hold that space with us in a non-judgmental way, and to capture the very essence of those feelings by sharing their own stories is essential. It's the ability to be able to share common experiences and not feel alone in this journey. The loneliest thing that I've ever had to do that ultimately aids your ability to heal in such a big way. So while my husband loves to cry, I hate to cry. I find it incredibly, incredibly difficult. And yet I often know that when I've had a really big cry, I feel so much better afterwards. And it's a really important part of your healing journey. You never get over your grief. You carry it around with you always. You will always be recovering rather than being recovered. Grief is complicated. The reality is that you will grieve forever. You will not get over the loss of a loved one. You will learn to live with it, though. You will heal, and you will rebuild yourself around the loss you have suffered. You will be whole again, but you will never be the same. Nor would you want to be the same, nor should you be the same. On some days, you'll be feeling okay, like you might be starting to deal with this just a little. That the happiness to devastation ratio isn't always 0 to 100 anymore. And then something happens, a photograph, a memory, a significant date, an insensitive person, and it takes you back to that deep dark place. But what does become easier is that you don't stay down there for as long as you did in the beginning. Your ability to duck under the wave instead of being dunked by it does become easier. Often when you are thrown into grief, it feels like it impacts on every single part of your life, and that your entire life is awful and that nothing will ever go right. And it's really important to try and foster an attitude of gratitude. Sheryl Sandberg talks about it as the three P's. personalization, which is the lesson that not everything happens because of something that we did. Pervasiveness, which is the belief that an event will affect all areas of your life. The lesson is that there are some things in life that are not awful, and these are the things you need to hold on to. And then there's permanence, which is the belief that the sorrow will last forever. But it isn't true, as hard as that can seem in the beginning. Accept your feelings, but know that they won't last forever, or at least their depth won't. When you replace why is this happening to me with what is this trying to teach me, everything shifts. I've tried to steer clear from the three P's as much as I possibly can, and to remember to count my blessings. Murray, James, our marriage, our home, my work, my family and friends, to mention just a few, and not to allow the tragedy of my life to dwarf everything else. One of the things that has been proven to help resilience is taking time to count one's blessings every single day, rather than dwelling on what you have lost. So I have a resilience journal, and I spend 5 minutes before I go to bed writing down three things that day that I was grateful for. It can be as simple as, I received a WhatsApp from a friend I haven't heard from in a while. I had a delicious banana muffin. It doesn't have to be anything profound. It's just remembering that there are still good things in your life. I also list, the other thing is you need to write them down. It's not just about thinking about them. It's actually about writing them down. I also listen to a TED talk or podcast every single day, where others share their stories and where I can learn something new. And often, this makes me realize how extremely lucky I really am. Another biggie for me, and something that I'm only really getting to grips with now, is the fact that I can't control everything. And that I need to learn that some things, despite every single one of my efforts to the contrary, will be what they will be. And I expect that this will be a challenge for a lot of you sitting in this room, because DSG girls are generally molded as type A personalities who like to be in control of pretty much everything. And there is nothing wrong with this at all, but it's also understanding that even this does have its limitations. You don't have a right to the cards you believe you should have been dealt. You have an obligation to play the hell out of the ones you're holding. When I was growing up, I was taught that if I tried hard enough, worked hard enough, that nothing was out of my control, and that I could achieve absolutely anything that I wanted to. This was all really great in theory and incredibly inspirational, but unfortunately in practice, it isn't always realistic or possible. James says that I'm the most stubborn and pig-headed person he has ever met. I prefer to think of it as being determined and focused, but I've learned that even that has its challenges. Through everything that's happened to us the last 3 years, and my single-minded determination to try and have another child, our fight with infertility, which very nearly cost me my life last year, and that's for a very different story. I'm not going to share that with you today. But what I have learned is that sometimes it doesn't matter how hard you try and how much you push. Some things really just are unattainable. The only thing certain is change. We need to learn to let go of the dreams of what we felt life should look like, and rather embrace what life looks like. Because the one thing you can control in your life is the choice you make on how you live it. You have a choice to thrive every day rather than just to survive, to make this a wonderful life and to live it to the full, if for no other reason than to honor those who didn't get this beautiful opportunity. Bad things happen to everybody. It's what you decide to do in the aftermath that really reveals who you are, to yourself and to others. And so, in conclusion, I'd like to leave you with a few things. To the person comforting a grieving friend, it is okay if you don't know what to say. You don't have to try and fix them. Although your words can't make their heartache better, your presence and stillness can help ease their pain. Just show up. Listen a lot and say little. Understand that your loved one will be forever changed. Nurture them, love them, feed them, envelop them in kindness and patience. Remember that for them, Every single day is a struggle, and the best thing you can do is just to be there. To the person grieving, you won't think it possible now, but you will get through this. Somehow, you will have the strength to crawl along this dark tunnel, which often seems to never end. There will be a darkness inside you and around you, but as time goes on, you will start to see and experience a little bit more light. You will be a different person, forever changed by this experience. You will never get over this, but you will learn to live with it. People will tell you that it will get easier. In my experience, it doesn't get easier, but it does get softer. You will learn to find some kind of acceptance. The nightmare that you feel you are living becomes less vivid. And while it's always there, a lifelong sentence, you won't remain doubled over in pain forever. And so, when you're face to face with an undeniable sorrow that you can neither alter nor reverse, you are given a unique opportunity to learn what many others are fortunately spared. You learn about yourself, the people around you, the potential of the future, and your undeniable strength, all beneficial as you move forward with your life. A changed life, but life nonetheless. Grief gives you a resilience you didn't know you had. I think more often than not, people are surprised by their own resilience, what they can withstand, and the fact that life can actually carry on, and most importantly, that you can actually feel and find joy again. This feeling can often also make you feel guilty. I know, still sometimes to this day, if I sing along to a car on a radio, really enjoy a meal out, just feel much lighter. I feel guilty because it makes me feel that maybe I'm forgetting my loved one and that I'm moving on. And one needs to keep on reminding yourself that this is not the case at all. That being able to live again in an altered reality doesn't mean that you have forgotten the person or that you love them any less. It just means that you know that life is worth living, that the person who has left this earth wouldn't want you not to carry on, that they would want you to live your best life, if for no other reason than to honor them and the life that they didn't get the opportunity to live. Thank you very much.